Performance, really great playing, awesome. Can you remind me what your name is? Emmeline, I think. Am I right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Nice to meet you. I'm Ella. I'll be having this class with you today. Really great playing. You have the technique, you have the understanding of this piece. You have the fluency, you're using pedal great. You have no trouble switching hands over each other. So great. I will just add a couple touches here and there and maybe want to talk to you about, let's say, sound aesthetics that go with the fact that this is Debussy and impressionistic music, which you are mostly getting, but I think there are some sections where you could explore some more special sound quality even more. So I will just ask you, first of all, I'm sure you do know that Debussy, that's impressionistic style, impressionistic period in music, but do you know what that means actually?
I don't think as well as I could.
Oh, okay. So I will just be as brief about it as possible. And there was a style that started in France. It was called Impressionism. And actually, who started it was painters, not musicians. I don't know, maybe you're familiar with Claude Monet's painting, The Sunset, I think, or Sunrise. I don't want to be mistake. It's telling you lies right now. But the general idea was that instead of showing the details and painting everything realistically, those painters decided to show blurs of colors, use single brush strokes basically, and kind of instead making an impression of an object that they were depicting. And then musicians kind of thought, it's an awesome idea, let's do the same with our instruments. So what you can take from that's what I just said, that it started with the painters, is especially if you think about watercolor painting. When you have watercolor painting, there is a very blurry background that is like the basis of the whole picture. And then the closer you are from to the observer, the clearer the edges are starting to be and the more details we can see. So we're doing the same with impressionistic pieces. So those blurry backgrounds, I would say, let me find a good spot to show you what I mean. Like for example, that section that is going on the bottom of page 8. When you are playing, what do we have here? These ones, left hand gives us, that's like a basis of the whole thing. Then those kind of details that should be standing out a little more are those octaves with auto markings. So what you're doing, you're kind of singing very well the eighth notes, the melody here. In this cantabile romantic, I would say, kind of way, I would keep that singing. That's perfect what you're doing. I would just try to find the sound that is less articulate and less out there, a little hidden. And on the other hand, try to show those staccato octaves. Mm-hmm. Let's try just that section and let's see how that will work. Yes, we are closer, but I think you can still try not to think about these notes, that they have to be so separate. For now, even forget about what is written. I know that it says mezzoforte, and then those octaves say piano. It can be it can sound as if I was going against the music right now, but I really think whenever impressionistic composers put staccato over some notes, it meant for them like, this is the clearer edge of that picture, that watercolor painting that we were painting. Show us that. So if you already show us that high register melody so well and so clearly, it's really very hard to show something else as well. So we have to make that a little more blurry and gentler so that this can stand out. Two different colors. Nice. And just for the experiment, can you try just the right hand? And for now, let's try and play that piano. And I want you to try different kind of articulation that may not even apply to that place, but instead of playing each note separately with a separate impulse, I would like you to try to kind of just touch those keys and then roll your fingers almost over them. So you're not even going all the way deep down to the keyboard, to the bottom of the keyboard. You're just pressing them as much as you need to make them sound.
3 more minutes.
Yeah, you can definitely experiment with that. There will be pianos on which this is more difficult to do, and on some otherwise it's easier. But that's some of the kind of technique that you can use here and there. And another spot where I think you can treat those fast notes in a little more blurry way, I would say, is at the very end when we are having this approaching climax. Very, very hard on showing us each and every of the 16th notes. I don't really think that's the idea. I think it's more like a whoosh, again, a coloristic whoosh in the background of changing harmonies on the left hand. So I would emphasize the rolled chord.
Okay.
And these are just kind of. Rolled.
Oh, shoot. Oh, I disconnected your phone somehow. How do I get off this?
Looks like something's going on with the
audio. Yeah, we're having some problems with the sound, but I don't think it's on your end.
Or somebody. It doesn't look like anyone's unmuted. Well, that was tragic. We've lost Emmeline. Hopefully she pops back on. We just had a couple more minutes left, but I'll see if she pops back on before we jump to our next player.
Thank you.
Tell me your name one more time.
My name is Cedar.
Cedar, what a beautiful name and what a beautiful pianist. This is a fabulous performance, and the sound quality over there, I can hear everything that you're doing, I think as well as Zoom can possibly be. So I'll be working with you for just a few minutes here. I absolutely enjoyed your performance. I think it's extremely well prepared, high level of detail, and then of course the most important, it's really in the spirit of the music, I think. It's full of life, which is, you know, I think there's so many classical sonatas out there. And Haydn, he's just one of my favorite composers. I love Haydn. But in this piece, he marks as the sort of weather conditions at the beginning, Allegro, which tells us fast, and then con brio, which tells us what? What does brio mean to you?
Brio?
Yeah.
I don't know what that means. Sorry.
Yeah, it's you know, I think life or vivacity.
Alive, yeah.
Yeah, with like a spirit, a zest. Mm-hmm. And so if you want to say that word the right way, you have to hold your hand like this, you know? Yeah, and say, con brio.
Con brio.
Yeah, exactly. Italian speaking mode is engaged when you hold your hand like this. Yeah, it's a really different than just Allegro, right? He didn't say fast. He felt something special about the spirit of this piece. And I think you're capturing it, even if you don't know what brio means, and that's fine.
Thank you.
Bravo. We just have a few minutes, so I'm just going to concentrate on a few details. You scanned in your score, and I'm so grateful to Professor Izzola because she actually sent it to us so that I can see a little bit of your loving teacher's markings on your score here. This is all of your markings from lessons, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, I just have to say, you are one lucky girl.
Yes, I am, for sure.
This is everything which is marked on your score so lovingly, I just have to 100% agree with. And if you're like me, when I was a student, you know, I think it's proven that about half of the details you get in lessons, whoosh, they just go right over your head. You're so nervous to play your best, right? And so you're focused on just doing your best. I don't know if you ever record your lessons, but you seem like you're a little bit like me when I was a student, and that a lot of the things my teacher reminds me of, I may forget when I go home to practice. It's a silly suggestion, but I would totally recommend taking this score and just scanning it like you are the scanner that you use to send it to me. Every little marking on the page from your teacher, try to make sense of it. And see if you can actually change the sound with it. It's a lot of really great suggestions. I was listening, and then I went to go make a couple of marks, and I saw, oh, it's already written there. So it's some really great suggestions from your teacher, and I think that they're fabulous, and they might help you get even closer to the composer in this case. It's a really wonderful performance. It just everything is there. Great sense of pulse, great sense of fire and character, and wonderful technical precision. It's great. It's going really well for you. It's hard piece to play. So I just have a couple of suggestions, though, some small details if you have time. I think if I had to give one comment for the whole performance, I would say that your left hand is probably a little bit prominent in the sound for this style. It's not your fault. It's a little bit of the instrument's fault. Our piano, it not only gets lower as you go to the left, it also gets louder. I don't know if you noticed that, but if you play with the same velocity here like this, eventually this will overpower the top with no problem. So when you play textures like this, the left hand can really kind of overpower the right. So just one practice suggestion, I would take this entire piece just as a one-day experiment and learn to play the whole piece right hand fortissimo, left hand pianissimo, whole thing. And see if you can get a little bit more clarity to the sound. When I do this, I find a second benefit, and that is my right hand has an easier job with all of the technical pitfalls in the piece, because it's not having to work so hard to get out the sound. So one place like this, you know, this is just a death trap for everyone. It's so difficult, right? Play that unison scale, especially when you're nervous. If the left hand is not, it's not blasting over the right, it's so much easier to play. I just want you to try this. Play the first time. I want you to play equal volume, just like you did. Try it. Now, one time, very slowly, left hand, like a piece of cotton candy, right hand is like sparkling, you know? And now just give me a little bit of a bubble on each beat, a little tiny accent. Take the accents away and go a little faster. Left hand twice as soft. To me, the sound is already clearer. So I would recommend this actually through most of the piece. You may find it's an easier piece for you technically that way too. But it's not your fault. Some of it's the piano. This machine that you're playing is built for romantic music, not for classic music. If you would have played one of Haydn's piano, you would be amazed. You can just blow on the keys and they will go down. It's so light. It's pretty incredible. These little guys, just a little detail. I might even try to play those accacciatura on the beat, like just a little crushed note. Almost together with the next note, instead of placing them so precisely before, you just get a little bit more zip on those downbeats. You want to try it?
Yeah.
I love that. Then you can concentrate on the kind of the difference between the harmonies. If I'm thinking, the last one is so sweet and sensitive, it's a deceptive cadence. Can you back off from that one? Yeah, try the whole thing. Yeah, that's so nice. If you can get that change in the sound while keeping that pulse just steady, it'll be so beautiful. So some other little details, where was this? Oh, you know, I have one little technique spot. This, it's kind of in the end of the development and the left hand has this gnarly passage. Do you know where that is? It's like measure 49, something like that.
Yes, I see that.
Yeah, isn't that tricky? Can you play your left hand for me there? Ooh. Great. This is another one of those passages that I think lightening up can help a little bit. So I just want to try one little experiment. We're going to give a nice gratuitous accent to the first 16th note, and the others we get for free. It's like a buy one, get three free deal. Like this. Try this rhythm. Very close. That's the rhythm that will not help this passage. I want to hold the first note. So like this. This rhythm, it's kind of holding the first note like a tied quarter note. Yeah, And see if it helps you to lighten up that left hand. That is a tricky passage because it makes our hand go from teeny tiny whole step out to a huge octave. That's a tough place. It needs some extra attention, I think.
Yeah.
Just a couple more minutes.
So I think that may be all the time that we have. Do you have any questions for me just in your experience with the piece?
No, I don't think so.
No,
think
you're okay.
This will be wonderful.
Yeah, I love your pulse with this piece. If I had a third comment, it would be to try to let the music breathe a little bit more between phrases. You know, there are long phrases in this piece. If you think about your arm, you know, if you try to take rubato and Haydn, it's kind of like sometimes trying to make a joint where there is no joint. But here, where there's a cadence, you know, the music can be flexible. So you can take a little bit more time to breathe before you start the next character. So I'm thinking of a place like, that is just a quarter rest, but that's one of the natural joints in the music. And you could take a little pause there. I took just a smidgen longer than a quarter note there. I think there are places throughout the piece you could open up just a little bit more, take a breath, and start the next thing. It's kind of like a conductor getting everybody ready to start the next passage. And it helps you to change characters and just helps the music breathe a little bit, I think. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does for sure.
Yeah. Okay, good. I know I've kind of talked you to death here. I really don't want to waste too much time. But I just want to tell you how much I enjoyed the performance and your precision, your well-preparedness, and congratulations. It was a great performance.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bravo, very cool piece. Yeah, this is so great to hear you. This is obviously not your first rodeo, right? Have you written some other compositions before this? And tell us a little bit about kind of, have you been writing since you were a little kid, or is it something you just kind of started recently? Tell us about your background.
I started like within the last year.
Oh, really? So it's kind of a new thing for you. That's really cool. Yeah. And then where do you live? Are you in Logan, or where's home for you?
I live in Lehigh.
Lehigh. Okay. Well, you're doing some great stuff already. Now, do you pronounce your name Maddox? Is that right?
Yeah.
It's a great composer name. That's one thing I'm already jealous of, is you've got Maddox Buchan. It's just like, it just sounds like a composer. And my name doesn't really. Kevin Olson has never been a really great composer name, so I've had to fight that. So I'm already jealous of your name. But you've got a great sound as well. Do you know what what musical elements you're using? Is this major, minor? What's your scale that you're kind of playing around with?
I can't remember the name of the mode.
Starts with an L.
Lorien?
Almost. Lydian. Yeah. It's a great mode, isn't it? It's got this really bright sound instead of the regular. I love the fact that you're starting to experiment with the modes, because it takes major and minor and gives it an extra color, right? Can you play everybody a G Lydian so they can kind of hear the mode you're playing with? Yeah. And what kind of color or what personality does that bring out to you? What do you think of when you hear Lydian?
I feel like with the raised fourth, it's kind of a mysterious feeling.
Yeah, it's got a little bit of that. It's a little mysterious, right? It's got a little bit of that. Almost like we're kind of separated from the real world a little bit. It's got a little bit of Debussy kind of impressionistic sound. So I love that you're playing around with the modes. That's the first thing I really love about your writing. The second thing I really like is that you're not afraid of space. I think a lot of young composers just try to cram as many notes in every measure as they can. And I love how you just let the music kind of sit and we can hear that sound, and then you move on to the next stuff. So that's the second thing, and keep doing that, using the space in your music. Number three is that you're not afraid of exploring the register of the piano. I feel like a lot of composers have ledger line phobia, right? It's kind of like a pain to write all those ledger lines. And it's like, oh, I'll just keep it right here in the middle of the piano. But the piano has this great range of color, and you're really exploring that higher range. One thing I don't really hear as much in this piece, and you might want to explore, especially a piece called Deep Sea, is the lower range. I would really love to hear these. That kind of sound. So when you set that up really high, that was awesome. It's almost like sunrise over the ocean. And then when you get bigger, maybe we get to explore the kind of depth of being on the ocean. Have you ever been to the ocean?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you know what we're talking about. The ocean has a different personality depending on the day, doesn't it? Sometimes when I've been on the ocean, like the morning, it'll be kind of calm and maybe kind of cloudy, foggy. And then it might be, you know, just beautiful, sunny day. But then there might be a windstorm in the afternoon and it gets a little rough. It might be fun for you to really explore all those colors and personalities of the ocean, because it's a great title. What I think we'll do right now is I'm going to share my screen so we can see the score together and talk a little bit about some of these things. I think that's all I need to do. Okay. Can you see the score on there, Maddox? You can on the computer? Great. All right. So one of the most important things, of course, we have to do as composers is we have to make the job easy for our performers, right? We don't want them to have to ask us any questions or have typos or any type of thing that's kind of harder to read. My own personal preference is, I think above like three or four ledger lines, I like to shift into 8VA. I think that would be really smart at the beginning. And then they're basically playing the same notes, right? Your left hand will be here your right hand will read those same notes, but it'll say 8 VA above. It's not like we can't figure it out, but we as pianists, we're kind of lazy, aren't we? When it gets to 3 or 4 ledger lines, we're like, oh, I don't want to count that high. Flute players, violin players, they're used to looking at and counting ledger lines. But pianist, I kind of feel like we have to put 8 VAs for us. So that might be something to think about as you're putting this together. A couple of other things. I really like the detail that you've got. You're very detail oriented as a composer. You remind me a lot of the kind of way that Debussy and Ravel write, because you have crescendos and decrescendos almost in every single measure, which is really great. You've got to be careful not to be maybe too detailed. For example, something like on 28, right at the end of that measure there, we probably don't need all of that. That goes by so fast. It might not be worth doing all that kind of stuff where you hold it and then you hold the one note, because that measure goes by really fast. So if I had to decide, I would just probably make that a dotted quarter note and call it a day, right? And there's a couple other places where I appreciate the attention to detail, but I don't know necessarily if we need those ledger lines, for example, not ledger lines, sorry, the slurs on 11. I think with the pedal, don't you agree? It's probably smooth enough already. So you probably don't have to worry about that. And definitely, I'm a lazy pianist. I'm not going to want to read 16 all the way up there. I'm going to want to get an 8 VA to make my life easy. So those are the kind of things that I think you can look through your score and try to make it as clean as possible. And that's the kind of thing that editors, publishers, they're going to want to look at that as well, because they want to sell this music, right? And they don't want their customers to be confused or for it to look really unnecessarily difficult and things like that. You and I could go through all sorts of different places where those types of things can be cleaned up. Tell me a little bit about your compositional process. Does this come from improvisation? Do you just kind of sit at the piano and noodle and then write it down? Or is this just coming in your head and you're putting it down? Or how do you do it?
I think it's a combination of both. I'll kind of get an idea and I'll explore it. And once I'm happy with it, I'll like write it down, but not right away. I'll just write, because I mean, I have a lot of ideas. Some of them I didn't even use for this piece, so I'll just write notes about them. And then once I have like enough notes, I'll decide where I want to put this and kind of then note it out, I guess.
Yeah. No, you're thinking like a composer. This is exactly how composition works, right? Is that kind of incubation process. You're kind of playing around with ideas. You come up with a theme that you really like. One thing I think you're doing really well that a lot of students struggle with is that you don't get tired of your ideas very soon. I like that. In other words, instead of saying, okay, I said that 2 times, I'm going to go on and say something completely different. I like the way that you explore and continue with your ideas. You know, I think this main theme, I think, is really nice. And you're not in too much of a hurry to get off of that. Notice it comes back again at 12 and 13, right? And then at that point, you're kind of like, okay, I've said it 2 times. Maybe I need to do something a little different, but you don't make it so crazy different that we're kind of like, as an audience, confused, right? You make it work really, really well. I think that's great. One thing that I think you might play around with in a piece like this is playing around a little bit with rhythm. Your piece pretty much settles into a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, which is kind of nice because it's like a boat rocking on the ocean, right? But every once in a while, it's kind of nice to surprise the audience. Instead of, we saw a piece earlier that did this, that was kind of in a 6-8, and then it switches kind of to a 3-4. So instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So you may do something like this. And maybe if you want to really get crazy, maybe you surprise the audience sometimes by not giving us the whole 6 beats, right? What if you went like 6-8 and then you go to 5-8? So 1, 2, 3. That kind of thing. So you may now start to explore. One of my favorite things as an audience member is when I get surprised. I'm like, oh, I know what Maddox is going to do. And then you do something else. And that's really fun as an audience. So as a composer, you set those expectations up and all of a sudden it's like, oh, we didn't see that coming. And the other thing I think could be really fun about this piece, besides exploring the lower part of the piano, might be right here. I think you have a real opportunity at 32 to 35 to give us something that kind of slows down that surface rhythm, right? Instead of the left hand doing, you kind of get really slow, right? And I feel like at 35, you were too antsy to get off of that new idea. I think it'd be great to explore. Maybe down lower. Maybe down lower. We've had so much G Lydian that when you give us that D Lydian, it's so great, but you only give it to us for four measures, right? So I would play around with maybe thinking about that D section expanding just a little bit. Do you have any questions about maybe this piece or kind of how it would work? Or do you have any plans of expanding it or doing other things with it? Or are you kind of ready to move on to the next piece?
I'm kind of ready to move on.
Yeah.
But I did like composing it. I feel like it was a great piece.
It turned out really great. You need to hold on to this for sure. And I could see this piece turning into maybe one of several movements, right? Maybe you have a whole suite called, you know, ocean scenes, for example. And the first movement is called Deep Sea. And the next one is maybe called Beach at Sunrise. And the next one's called Storm on the Open Seas or something like that, right? So maybe that could be a good challenge, is for you to try to write multi-movements of the same thing. The other thing that you may do, which would be really cool to see, Maddox, do you play any other instruments?
No.
Do you have any friends that play in band or orchestra or something like that?
Well, my mom plays in orchestra.
What does she play?
Violin.
Oh, how cool would it be to put a violin part against this, right? So you've got your piano kind of being the ocean waves, and you've got this beautiful violin. I've used all my friends and family that play different instruments to write music for them. And that could be really fun. And you'll learn a lot from that. As you get older, you're going to start writing string quartets, eventually maybe for orchestra, big band pieces and things like that. Maybe even for your own school, your high school band or something like that when you get into high school. So start playing around with writing for those other instruments too. Okay.
Okay.
Good. Hey, I am really interested in what you're doing. So if you ever want to send me a score or have any questions for me or about getting into publishing or writing for different instruments and things like that, send me an email. I'd love to communicate with you about what you're doing because you're a hotshot. You're doing some really cool things and exploring stuff that usually kids don't even know about until high school or college. I didn't know about modes until college. So you're way ahead of where I was. So I'd love to talk to you more about this stuff. Keep it up, okay?
Thank you.
Great to meet you. Nice job.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bravo. Yeah, congratulations. Very nice play. Your name is Angela, am I right? Yes, okay, nice to meet you, Angela. I want to ask at the beginning, why do you think this piece is called A Memory of Vienna? What does it refer to?
I feel like it refers to like, well, at the beginning, it's like slow and like, it's like slow to like start up, and it's like when you, I feel like it's like when you tell a story and it's like starting the story and there's like a sense of like getting into it.
Yes. That you're very right. You're talking about why it's called A Memory. And I would like you to explore a little more that second part of the title. Why is it A Memory of Vienna? Does anything ring a bell when you see Vienna? And you have a piece written in 3/4. No, a Vienna waltz. And this is why it's A Memory of Vienna, because the whole piece is basically a waltz. So if you have a waltz, I don't know if you've ever danced actually a waltz, but when you do, you take the first step is always longer, and the second and the third one are up in the air and are shorter. So it's like 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So when we talk about the waltz, what it changes is that actually we don't have the very metronomic three even beats. We have a slightly longer first beat, and then the second and the third one are a little squeezed together. So it's okay. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1. And if you add that little detail to the piece, it will start to move much more and it will get nice fluency and it will resemble a walk much more. Let me show you what I mean by this at the beginning. Obviously, first we start off with tremolos, and then it's one. So it's not metronomic, it's not even all the way through. It's kind of like we're sitting down on the downbeat a little longer, and then you can move, you can go forward. So it will technically mean that each downbeat can be just, each second beat can be a little delayed. 1, 2, and here you have to go forward on the eighth notes. And I know that it's technically difficult because those are thirds, but it's totally doable. Can you just try first on the right hand, those ti da da dum, a little faster. That's right, you can do this. There's no technical issue that's holding you back. So now let's add left hand and try to get into that weird pulse that I'm talking about, this 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, always delaying a little bit the second beat and then squeezing the space between the second and the third one. Okay, let's try it, just the beginning. Okay, yeah, that's already much better. It's already much fluent, much more fluent. And then all together, I think those first measures can just go forward and then you can relax on the third and the fourth measure. So again, this is kind of out of the general pulse and starting faster and stretching. And then the same thing will go back again. So we are kind of thinking in a bigger chunk of four measures where we want to go forward during the first two, and then we want to stretch and relax on the third and the fourth one. Does it make sense what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, let's try that then. Yes, very good. I think you can exaggerate it. I want you to experiment for me right now. So do something that you think will be completely I don't know, against all the music rules, untasteful, and it will be horrible. I want you to really speed up during those first two measures and then really slow down during the third and the fourth one. Exaggerate it totally for me. Okay, that's right. That's already much better. You can really let yourself do even much more, much more. And then another thing about that little section that we have is that each time you end those four measure phrases, left hand has something to say at the very end. And he even writes those crescendos and decrescendos on this part. I think you can let left hand be a little more important here. I would really emphasize that little tenor voice. And then on the next line, you have a similar thing. Here, right? You know what I'm looking at? Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's maybe start from measure five. So the second phrase, and remember to show us the left hand a little more. And let's play just the beginning of the next line. All right. Okay. Uh-huh. Very good. And what do you think has to happen on this third system? So starting from measure nine, musically. Can you actually say again, because you're muted, I couldn't hear you. Yeah. I mean, muted, you're very quiet. You can speak up a little.
Okay, I feel like it gets a little faster and like more like lively.
Yes, exactly. Poco più animato is exactly what you just said. It means a little more animated, so a little more lively. And you can start it right from the beginning. It's also mezzo forte, so it's both a little more animated and louder at the same time, right? So right where it starts, kind of the same idea. We want to press forward in the middle of that four measure phrase, and at the end, you can give that time a little back and slow down, but really move forward during the beginning. Okay, that was better. And then between that little phrase and the next one, what do you think is the most striking thing that is happening? What's the most interesting thing?
I feel like it's like the mood. The first one is like kind of like, it's more like a happy, and the other one is kind of like kind of sad and like.
Yeah, yeah. So that's character wise, and you're absolutely right about this. And what happens musically is that we have a modulation to a strange, let's say, key at the beginning of that. We have this E flat major with a seventh, minor seventh there. It's a very jazzy chord all of a sudden here. So before we just have playing E flat seventh, and then on measure 13, it gets jazzy and weird at the beginning. So I would enjoy that modulation a little more, by which I mean probably I would put a fermata over that chord to kind of let yourself and the listeners just hear and appreciate that weird modulation. If you just pass it by metronomically, we won't notice that even. And if you do something like this, let me start on measure nine maybe. And we follow you and we're like, oh, that's really something interesting, but you need to give us time to notice that, right? Let's try the same chunk I just did. So from measure nine again, and then maybe just first measure of the bottom system.
Professor Blocka, we have about one more minute.
Okay. Yeah, you can can definitely exaggerate it even more, but that's the idea. We're definitely closer. And I want to do exact same thing on the last measure of the same page, because what is happening here from this D flat major, we're getting to A major seventh. It's totally two different worlds, a key with flats and right next to it, a key with sharps. So you have to, again, give us some time to adjust to that. Can we play just those two measures? Maybe a little awkward, but let's try measure 15 and 16, just the downbeat. Oh, yes. That's better. That's much more interesting this way. And the last thing I just want to kind of touch, because I know I'm running out of time, let's look at measure 32 and the dead transition. So you're treating these tenuto markings that he put as accents and as something that straight away goes forward. But actually he writes poco più animato on the next measure. I think what he needs us to do on that previous measure is actually the opposite thing that you are thinking of. So I feel very much that when we're ending, I'll try from measure 31, we're coming out of that. This is stretched. And after this, yes, for sure, it will go forward. You can be as free as you want. But that single measure is kind of like expanding space and go from the downbeat. Does that make sense? Let's try that from measure 31. And I think we'll have to finish after that. Okay, that's much closer. What you could add to this is the starting the downbeat of measure 33 a little later. So simply, that was very nice, but just wait for that downbeat a little longer and that will be perfect. Okay, I think I have to finish right now, but it was great working with you, great meeting you, and I wish you all the best for the future.
Thank you.
Yeah, Finley, great work. Yeah, really some beautiful playing. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Awesome. Okay, and I can hear you. Great. Yeah, excellent sound quality and the transmission even over Zoom. We could still feel all of that passion and everything you put into it. What grade are you in school right now?
Eighth.
Great. And which high school are you at? Are you at junior high?
I'm in middle school.
Middle school. Yeah. Well, you have a very kind of an older sound for sure. And you're really starting to channel in that artistic playing. Obviously, you've got some great teaching and she's helping you really start to channel in kind of your own personality and artistry. I think a lot of things we tend to do with students your age is to really try to pull out that artistic side and make you sound more free and natural. And you're getting that. I mean, you really have a wonderful personality that you end up expressing. So I'm kind of more interested in just finding out your process in this piece specifically. You don't get much help with the title, right? It's just intermezzo in F minor. So what are you kind of trying to portray? Is there a personality, a story, a mood? What are you going for in this piece?
Just on like expressing yourself on like with different dynamics, like crescendos and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Timothy Brown, he's a friend of mine. He's a composer in Dallas. And I really like him because he writes in this style that kind of prepares you to play some of the bigger works, like the Brahms intermezzos or the Chopin intermezzos and others. Do you know what an intermezzo is? Do you know what the title refers to?
Like in the middle or something like that?
Yeah, it's kind of a weird title. In the middle of what, right? I mean, you started and you finished. Yeah, it literally is. That's the literal translation. It comes from music that would be played during between acts of like an opera. Like if you've ever been to, a play or something like that, and the curtains close and then there's a little bit of music and then the curtains open again, it gives the actors a chance to reset the stage and to go to the next scene. So you can imagine if there's no singer or nobody on the stage, the music can be a little more free, right? So I've always thought of intermezzos to be a little bit more improvisatory, right? And to be thinking that way. And I think that's what you do really well in this piece is you make it super free and flexible, and it'll lead you into other romantic works that do the same thing. I also think it's great, Finley, that you have focused so much on the phrasing, right? You know that that's the end of the phrase, and then it starts on the upbeat, right? So I think you're really thinking about how each of those individual phrases start and end, and then a little bit of a lift before you come back into it. So many good things. I'm only going to focus on just a couple of little details, and these things, obviously, all of these things are personal. So if you and your teacher are kind of like, I don't know, that's okay. That's the beauty of romantic music, right? Is you can kind of say, no, that works for me, and that feels authentic to me, and other things that don't, right? So let's go to the top of page 2. And one thing I'd like to do, because I know you've got the technique to do this, I think it'd be great to launch right into that trill right at 18. So when you... I think you can fit a lot more trill into that. Let's just try that line with a little bit more of a flashy trill. Yeah. And you can decide. I mean, you can slow it down maybe a little bit, but I don't think you need to change the tempo too much on that. One thing you might try to do. It kind of fades away, right? It's not like a big dramatic ending, right? So maybe not quite as long of a trill. I like all the trills you're putting into, but we don't need to have a ton of trilling. So it just kind of ends up just the ends of a sentence, but we're moving on to a new section. Let's try starting right that beginning measure again. Let's try that top of that page. Yeah, Yeah, let's practice that. That means your left hand has to get there fast, right? Try that a few times without really stretching. Yeah, and my own personal rule, with romantic music, and I know everybody plays ornaments just a little bit differently, but I've always kind of felt like the ornaments should start on the note in romantic. What you're doing is great for Baroque and even a lot of classical music where the note is above. I would start on the E, because what's really happening is just E, F. That's the most important thing. So I would start on the F, I would start on the E. Let's just try that measure where you have E, F, and without stretching. Yeah, now without slowing down, da, da. Try that, just humor me and try not to put too much time in it. Yeah. Maybe you wanna save that big epic one for the very, very end, right? So on page, on measure 57. Maybe that one becomes a little more epic. What do you think, Finley? Does that make sense? Yeah, and then it's not just copy paste, right? It's a little different, and we're like, oh, this one's a little more important or a little more final. Okay, good. How do you want the personality of the piece to change at 23? That's obviously our B section, right? How are you going to make it sound different to us?
Just like more crescendos and decrescendos, kind of like the phrasing.
Yeah, the composer gives you a couple hints, right? What are some directions you're getting at 23?
Like, I think it says leggero.
Yeah, do you know what that means? How's your Italian? Leggero?
No, I don't know what that means.
Okay, it means very lightly. So one thing that would be really great for you to always do, if you have any questions about a composer's marking, just Google it. Back in the old days, we had to buy big fat dictionaries and look it up. And my teacher used to always get on my case if I hadn't translated something. It's really easy for you. You can just get your phone out and you can type in leggero and figure out what that means. But lightly to me tells me just the opposite, that actually this middle section needs to just move a little faster and be a really light. So yours was kind of epic and heavy. And it was beautiful. I love that big sound. But let's experiment with what the composer does and make it move really quickly and softly. Okay. And then let it get a little bigger. Obviously by 31, we can be big. Okay. But let's start it soft. Okay. Try it at 23. Beautiful, really, really nice. Yeah. And this is a place where you might be able to show off some of your fast fingers. You've had a real good first page and a half where you can show off your expressive side. But this might be a place where, if it was me, it'd be like, oh, I gotta play all these 16th notes in a row. I'm just gonna rip through these. Let's try it. And just for fun, even if it's really sloppy because you haven't probably practiced it this fast, but let's just see if you can play. Just see what happens, okay? We might hate it and your teacher might hate it, but let's just see what it might sound like if it's faster and lighter. Yeah. I mean, maybe. And maybe you start it kind of slow. Maybe it's 23 starts like da 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 da. So this is the place you've done all the hard work with notes and rhythm. Maybe you start to explore and experiment even just a little bit more. Personally, I might not make the retard at 8:30 that epic because we've still got a little bit more to go and it's starting to build up, right? So. So he, you know, without the composer's permission on 30, I probably wouldn't do too much molto retard, especially because it's building and the momentum continues. Let's start at 28. Okay, and slow it down just a little bit, but not too much. That was a lot, right? That was a big, and I'm saying do maybe because we don't really even have a composer telling us to slow down. So I wouldn't take too much of that seriously. I'm not going to bug you about that, but I'm just going to put it on your radar, let you think about it and decide if that's something that you want to do. Okay, only two more things I want to say. Do you know what the little horizontal lines mean at 35, 36, 37 above those notes? What do the little kind of horizontal small lines mean?
Where?
Do you see above measure 35, measure 36, measure 37? Above your right hand, you get these, some of these notes. Have, what does that mean?
That's like playing it like longer, kind of like more yeah. Sound.
Yeah, yeah, tenuto, right? It basically means to just emphasize that note. So we're gonna go. So in the middle of all those fast 16th notes, we get this little hidden melody that's really long. C, B flat, A. Can you show me just the right hand and show me how you're trying to, just the right hand, bringing out those tenutos? Yeah, yeah. So I think when you're saying, and you said it yourself, hold it out, right? I try to hold. So while the other notes are moving, hold that pinky down. You might think, oh, the pedal's down anyway. No one's going to hear. You will be able to tell. So practice that slowly and see if you can do it. You may be doing that, but Zoom kind of clips out sometimes long notes. So you might be doing that and I just can't hear it, but I would really watch out for that. And then your trills at 38, same thing, start on the note. You were only doing, I think, one trill. You were only going. But I would do as many as I could. So it just makes those notes a little more important. Can you show me? I know you've got good trills. Show me 38, 39 with good trills. Yeah, I would try to decide how many I wanted to do. Definitely, you don't want to just do one. That's not a trill, right? So we want to have maybe I would do five. Maybe I can actually kind of count out how many I want to do. So the trills are roughly the same length to them. And let's finish off. Let me just see how you're going to plan on ending this. Right at 59. Let me hear that, and I'm kind of curious how much you pull back at the very end. Yeah. Beautiful. Let's do an experiment. Let's see what would happen if you actually did one big pedal and make it right at 60. How about a big sound there, big mushy sound that you clean out at 62. So all of this. And then, so it becomes really kind of intense and then you clean it up, okay? Let's try it starting at 60. Yeah, yeah. I think that's a really cool sound to have it really kind of a little bit mushy and intense. And then it's like the clouds lift and we just get this F minor chord at the very end. Play with that again. See if that's something that you and your teacher might want to do. Finley, you've got a great sense of kind of individual personality at the piano. This is something that usually takes a lot longer for students to develop. So I love the fact that you're fearless, that you're into kind of feeling the music and not just being a robot. This is where, you know, your artistic life goes at this point, is to decide between all the composer's marks, what exactly are you going to do to put your own personality in there and still keep the spirit of the original, right? So keep it up. You're doing some great stuff for eighth grade. I'm impressed.
Thank you.
Great to meet you.
Bye.
Congratulations. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bravo, Chase. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Awesome. I wish we had a huge hall of people clapping for this wonderful performance. Maybe next year we can do this in person. Congratulations to you. I have played a lot of Mozart and in my life, and every time I do it, I say, why did I put myself through this? I think it's so difficult to play Mozart. Some famous quotes of other musicians, a violinist named Isaac Stern, he said, it's very easy for amateurs and very difficult for professionals. I think Mozart is one of the hardest things to play at its most beautiful. And I just think you're doing an absolutely amazing job putting all of this together, and just huge congratulations. The pulse is alive and moving and free, wonderful clarity in your 16th notes and pacing through the piece. I can just feel so much of Mozart coming alive in your playing. So I want to ask you first, what was your experience like learning this piece, and what do you think of it now?
At first it was kind of hard, and like with like all the articulation and all like the rests, my teacher was very picky about the rests.
You're lucky to have a teacher that's picky about rests. It's a famous Mozart quote that the music happens most powerfully in the silences. Have you ever heard that before?
Yeah,
it's true. You know, have you ever listened to like a symphony play, and at the moments when they rest, you know, perhaps in between themes or between movements, it just hits your heart. You know, you suddenly feel the effect of everything that came before the rest. And then it's also anticipation of the next thing. Your teacher is very wise to be picky about the rest. I just want to ask Professor Izzola here, are we supposed to finish up at 1:30 for Chase?
Let's take a few more minutes. So how about 1:35, and we'll just start the advanced category a little bit late.
Okay, we get 8 minutes together, Chase, to cover this wonderful movement. Rests are so important in Mozart. I'm so glad that you mentioned articulation. Articulation is one of those things, I think when we're students, we say, oh, it's like extra, you know, like sprinkles on top of the cupcake. But it's really, I think in this style, essential. It's more like speaking a language, and where we know where to put the emphasis on different words and where to relax. This helps so much to just communicate what we're saying. Patterns of emphasis and de-emphasis. And that's, I already hear it coming alive in your playing. So keep working exactly on what you're doing with this. This is a kind of piece that in 2 or 3 years you'll come back to, and you'll play it like a totally different pianist, I promise. Just be patient. It's a beautiful performance. I enjoyed it very much. I want to focus on just a couple of things. And I think if I had to summarize them, they're both in the category of what we think of as dynamics or tone. In other words, how loud or how soft we're playing. There's kind of two ways to think about this. There's horizontal dynamics, probably what you think of as dynamics. You see a F and you play forte. You see a P and you play piano. One is more than the other. The best definition I ever heard for piano was not forte. I think that's the best definition. And especially in a Mozart score, he doesn't give you very much detail as a performer for what to do with the dynamics. And he expects a very high level of understanding and freedom from you. So there's kind of these horizontal dynamics. First, we think of big chunks, like a forte passage will be here and a piano passage here, right? And then there's also kind of micro dynamics that happen with what we call shaping. Have you ever worked with your teacher on shaping all of these passages?
Yep.
Yeah, so it's like playing louder or softer. I think the only general rule is that flat is more boring. So the more you can add shape and life to all of the horizontal lines, the more interesting the music will be, and the more interest your audience will have in what you're doing. Mozart, you know, his best pieces, I have to say, were not in his piano sonatas. He really was focusing so much on two different kinds of music. One was opera, which is singers, you know, with orchestra on stage. And oh man, he had so much ears for nuance that opera singers do in their melody lines. And this other one was piano concerto, which is also with orchestra. If you haven't listened to any Mozart operas or piano concertos, check them out. They're just, you could fall in love with that music so fast. So anyways, horizontal dynamics, in the form of shaping, right? And then also vertical dynamics and in terms of voicing, right? If we play all of the tones equally loud in chords, it can kind of cloud our perception of what's going on in the music. So in Mozart, we try to really be careful to balance the soprano against the bass. So if you think of playing chords, you know, like, let me have some chords here. yeah, there's a big one here, right before the second theme. If you play those all the same volume, we can't really understand as much about the music. Or even when you're playing a melody and accompaniment. Here, our right hand gets about, you know, twice as much sound maybe as our left. So I want to try just a few little experiments with you. We only have like 4 minutes together, so I want to make it as quick as we can. Maybe we can try that little second theme right there. Do you mind starting right here? And then, very soft left hand and very strong right hand. This is hard to know when to start and stop in an online class. Yeah, I would go for even lighter on those eighth notes in the left hand. I don't trust Zoom dynamics all the way either. Sometimes things come out louder than they really are. But I would just lighten up that left hand. Can you try this just like a floating cotton candy? Can you try that? Down this low and bring your right hand kind of to the closer viewpoint. I just love your 16th notes. It's very clear here. It's quite beautiful. Another place that's kind of dangerous for horizontal dynamics is where the left hand has the theme. This is dangerous. I think Dr. Olson mentioned with another student, you have repeated notes. If they're all the same, it can kind of wear our ears out. So think of the sneaking in and growing. Can you play your right hand right there? Absolutely. So each one of these, soft, louder, 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 loudest, and then getting softer. Try very slowly once like that. Really focus on the tone. I love that. Yeah, it's so funny. You know, if someone asked me to play a 12-note crescendo, I think I'd have a hard time playing it evenly. So even six notes can be hard. So yeah, I think that's the way to go in this. It can bring it to life so much. Variation of the louds and softs within the same dynamic, I think, will help this piece a lot. Yeah, and I'm so glad your teacher had you focus on the rests. There are still a few of the rests at cadences that you cheat just a little bit. I think you can take a long breath when you ever see two quarter rests. I want to focus on one other tricky spot, which I think balance will help. Do you know where this spot is? This awful trill at the end.
Yeah,
it happens twice. You want to look at the one at the end of the exposition. It's in F major. Can you play that once again for us? Good. I'm going to skip. You're at the very end in B flat. I'm going to skip there and learn this one. Good. So I want you to take your left hand for me for 1 second. I want you to play it just as loud and blastissimo as you can, every note. Now, I want you to do a buy one, get three free deal. Can you give your lowest bass note a little sparkle and get the top notes as light as you can? Sounds like this. That is hard. It's not your fault, Chase. You see this? It's not fair. That thumb is huge and that pinky is tiny, and we need them to have the opposite sound. We need the pinky to really lead here and the thumb to just be as light as a feather. Keep working on that. Try it once again, just very slowly. Loud, soft, 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 loud. Sound. Let your ears guide you. It'll be hard for your hands for a few days to get this rotation worked out, but as you lighten up that left hand, it will make the trill a little bit easier. You don't have to play as strong with this, and we just want this to be continuous all the way through. Very light left hand. It's kind of like their motor. Chugga 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 chugga. We don't need any more sound than that. And then your trill can be really nice and light. Can I hear your beautiful trill? Good. And same thing with a trill as any of the other melody notes. It's really just two notes. Remember when we did? And we made each of these louder. If you shape the trill, it will also be a little more clear. Can you try that? Good, yeah, it's like a little crescendo and then diminuendo. I love that sound. It's very tricky to get those little fine brush strokes in there, isn't it? Yeah, do you have any other questions or things that are kind of bothering you in this piece?
No, not really.
Yeah, it's. I think, like I said in the beginning, I think Mozart is deceptively difficult to play. There are so few notes. It's like you are under a magnifying glass the whole time, so there's nowhere to hide. And it's really just so delightful to play, though, when you're finally in control of all these balances. So almost everything that I hear that I would want to suggest for you to explore is in the world of tone. So it's the how you touch the keyboard and how loud or soft you play the notes. Think about it as you practice vertical dynamics and horizontal, how you balance the different parts of the texture. Congratulations again to you. I loved your performance. It has so much energy, and you made me want to play this piece. I read it a little bit last night, and I was thinking, it's such a delightful piece of music. It's so much fun to play. It's got so much contrast in it. Okay, well, I think we're out of time, so I wish we had more time, but congratulations again, and we'll see you next year.